We are going to have this panel discussion in English. Despite many efforts, even despite the fact that the majority of students in Iranian education are females, political, social, and economical leadership in Iran still remains male domain. In this panel, we will explore what obstacles prohibit women from rising to the top in Iran, and we will analyze what Iranian civil society in exile can or cannot do to promote gender equality in Iran. I will start the panel with asking the dear panelists to introduce themselves to the audiences, because I believe that they will better introduce themselves to you. I will start with Saga.
Hello, everyone. My name is Saqar Qiyasi. It's, don't bother, it's unpronounceable for you. And I didn't do any kind of activism in terms of to, you know, enjoying women's rights movement in Iran. I did some activism at the personal level that it's part from me from university and lots of things that it limited my choices. But when I came to Ireland, because my family, most of them are in UK and Ireland, it's like a promised land for my family, that I started activism from Irish women's movement, from women's movement in Ireland, most is correctly. And then it's 2009 election happened when, with all kind of oppressing and the human rights abuses. Then I started mostly human rights and political activism. And I went to Trinity College Dublin to study gender studies, philosophy in gender studies. And then now I'm a PhD student in Trinity College Dublin, Middle Eastern department, working on women's sexuality and their religion identity. And
what else? Is enough?
No, it's enough. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening, everybody. My name is Mansoura Shojai. I am a diaspora women activist, Iranian diaspora women activist in Europe.
It was little, so now I'm shy to give a long introduction. My name is Masih Ali Nejad. I'm a troublemaker for the government of Iran. That's all. I'm a campaigner against compulsory hijab, an online movement which allows Iranian women to protest against compulsory hijab, and that's all.
Thank you very much, all. It is always said that women in Iran are in progress in the term of getting higher roles in the politics. And those who support this idea, they always mention that, for example, the number of women in parliament has been increased, especially in the last election. It's increased up to 17, I think, I'm sure. And few women now are in cabinet, like the vice president. Nowadays, we have vice president for women affairs, Shahindokht Mollaverdi. And the head of department of environment is a woman, Masoumeh Ebtekar, together with some women who are engaged in different roles, like they are mayors or governors in smaller cities. And it is always mentioned that more women are going to university. Almost 70% of Iranian girls and women go to university. But at the same time, there is a fact that the rate of occupation in Iran is something around 20%, if we are very optimistic. And we will see that women are prohibited from getting higher roles in the government, in the state, like they are not allowed to be president, or allowed, and there is no tendency to choose women as ministers, except once we had never had any women minister in Iran, except one time. Yeah. Yes, and we will start the panel with this question. What do you think is the main reason for these prohibitions? Sagar, do you start?
Okay, sure. First of all, supporting, writing, talking about women's participation in politics is quite new phenomenon, even in West. It is started from 60s that they kind of questioned, they raised the fundamental question about women's position in politics. Look at the statistic that how many men or women are in parliaments. So I try to categorize two kind of obstacles. The first category, it's about some obstacles that it would apply everywhere in the world, West, East, it doesn't matter. In some extent, we can say these would be still obstacles. The second would be mostly unique to places like Iran or the similar places like Iran. The first one, I just give an example. This is our cliche perception, whatever you can name them. But I just give some example to understand what I mean by that. Politics are for men, or they say politics is a dirty game. Women are pure, or they are so soft for that. Or politics is mostly about men's networking. It's a kind of boy club. So women had difficulty to get this in club and disturb the order that they have. Or you can see that many politician men that they have son, they feel their shoes, but it doesn't much happen when it comes to the daughter. And financially, women can't really compete with men. The all kind of people at kind of investing in politics, they don't waste their money on women because they think that they have less chance to be elected, so they don't want to spend money on their losers. And some people would say that it should be on merit, not sex, biologically speaking. And they kind of ignore all radical obstacles towards women participation. It seems they are talking a word that the women and men are equal in any way, which we know it's not true. Or they say women are not interested in politics, which is not true. Even in Iran, that we at the end of Pahlavi times, that we have more than 323 women political prisoners. So if they are not willing for candidacy or it's in compared to men, there are other reasons that we should identify. When it comes to Iran, political activity is risky and is unwelcome, especially if you have a kind of the idea of secularism or past the red lines, so it's almost impossible. And society have a double standards when it comes to women. For example, when it comes to political prisoner, women political prisoner, always they question their motherhood and try to guilt trip with them that if Nargis Mohammadi is get 16 years imprisonment. So what about her kids? But never ever questioning men when it comes to their family to say how your family survived in Iran and how your kids been looked after. But women always have to answer this kind of question. Questioning women participation in parliament because we have misogynist women in parliament. They don't question misogynist men. I mean, misogynist men doesn't underestimate their place in parliament. But when it comes to women, always we have higher standard. So if they can't, most of them, they have a very bad record, although we had a good, in Iranian context, we had good candidate as well. But they always kind of questioning women when it's come to women equality. It seems that this is the women's job, not the all member of candidate. And there is other important things that we have. The position of women in Iran is quite controversial. We have traditional school of thought, which is we know all about it. The women are placed in home. They should look after kids, and they should be good wife. And even they want to leave the house, they should get permission from their husband. And we have the political Islamism that is totally different when it comes to that. I just give you an example of a person, Marzieh Hadidchi Dagbagh. He was a political prisoner during the Shah regime. I'll just finish in 2 minutes. Okay, sorry. Then she was enjoy Khomeini's to Paris in exile when Khomeini was in exile and stayed there 4 years, acting as a Khomeini security person. And then he was in Lebanon. Then he would train military tactics, and then she became military commander in Iran and Iraq war in Sepah-e Pasdaran. She served parliament 3 times, and more importantly and interestingly, she has 8 kids. And then you question, if it's a woman in place in home, how it's possible we have some of this kind of women in the Islamic Republic of Iran, that how is possible that there are some political sphere that the women are there, like Friday prayers, like all protests that is kind of defending states in ideology, all kind of the women going to different embassy and saying death to this, death to that.
I want to ask Mansoura, sorry that I call you all by your name, because it's a kind of a Swedish habit I got. Because, we don't use surnames too much. Mansoura-jan, you have been active in the women movement inside Iran for long time. And I believe that you have, you may have other observations about this issue. What do you think about the reasons of those prohibitions for Iranian women to get higher roles in politicians and management?
Thank you. First of all, I hope you will pardon me for my broken English. It's the first time. Actually, if I want to talk about the political participation, I prefer to divide between informal political participation and formal political participation. But before starting this issue, I prefer to talk about the obstacle, the barrier front of the women for getting the high job position, as you're asking me. For example, I can categorize, and as Sari categorize it, in 3 categories: legal obstacle, social and cultural barriers, and something else. The legal obstacle is about the our family law. In our family law, there is an article which the women, which obliges women, has the husband's permission to have a job, both in high level or in a ordinary level. So by this obstacle, the women with in the family with background, traditional and religion background, always have a lot of problem to get a job, to get a high level job or not. And the second reason, the second barrier, is social and cultural barrier. For instance, the social norm and male-dominated culture to divide the family managing between women and men, and look at the men as the only breadwinner. And this look denied women to have more possibility outside of household. And the third one is a global one, I believe, is lack of gender sensibility in labor work, in labor market, which is global dilemma. For example, the global look at the women, at the female citizen as a potentially pregnant, potentially breastfeeding, potentially single mother, potentially disappointed lover, or those who are suffering from monthly pain. And that's why it's a general dilemma. But in the case of my country, particular case in my country, I think the Iranian state find a strength of Iranian women as a potential threat to their power, which is based on male-dominated ideology. But in the political part, in the, for example, formal political part, if we want to talk about it, I want to start with a quotation of Political Women Network in Argentina. They said that, sorry, I have to read this quotation, with few women in politics, it is the women who change. With many women in politics, politics change. So, learning from feminists that the personal is political, we can say that the presence of every woman in the state could change the public opinion about the women, particularly in rural area, both in rural area and civic area, to look at the women as a powerful, as a you know, self-confidence. The women can reach a lot of self-confidence to have some kind of job. However, more women in politics does not necessarily make a just society by themselves alone. Anyway, we have to rely, it's a must for us, to rely the power of informal politics, such as women's grassroots activism, NGOs, cyber campaigns. Listen, Massey. To push and to support the women in the state. In this case, if we will be able to make a bridge, participatory bridge of informal politics and formal politics in all organs of government, we need to have a very strong civil society member, civil society women in Iran. Without this, as the Argentinian motto reminds us, only the women change, not politics.
But through this talk, I would like to ask Messi that it has been always a challenge and the question that if this quotation is true and if the more women in state will result to good changes for women. I would like to ask you, what do you think, Massey, about the role of those women who are in the state right now? Do you think they are helping the women's right to progress?
Such a good question, because I was a little bit nervous by listening to these fantastic talk. Because I used to be a parliamentary journalist.
That's why I asked you this question.
And I really admire all the activities that you've been doing. And I'm going to start from my personal story. When I was a parliamentary journalist, I had the fear to get involved with feminists inside Iran. Shirin Ebadi's name, Mehrangiz Kar's name, Mansoura Shojaei, they were my, not mine, the organization that I worked. Red line. They were not even able to give, small advertisement in our newspaper to promote women's situation or women's right or 1 million signature campaign. And in that time, even myself, I was just, my idea, my opinion was that we have to get women more involved in politics. And my main focus was just getting women more involved in politics and ignoring feminists and women rights activists inside Iran. One day I managed to go in an underground event, as you remember. Yeah. And I was surprised. I was surprised because all I've seen there, it was totally different from the place that I was working there, from Iranian parliament, from those female politicians. They were not even representing us as a journalist, rather than, because we were more strict compared to the young people, young women in public, in the streets. And those female politicians were not representative, not representing me as a journalist. And I told that time my brother that I met Mansoura Shojaei, she was singing.
Oh, I see.
Was surprised.
It was a secret.
So, and I said that I met Shirin Badi and she was not wearing hijab. So you see, some people might say, this is a small issue. But this is women's issue in Iran. And politicians always ignoring small issue. They never think that we are trying to fight with small minds. So when we talk about getting more women involved in politics, then we have to think what we want from them. When they're ignoring us, when they never even pay attention to those, you know, small demands in society. I'm not hopeless, especially when I think even Molaverdi can bring a huge change. She can be there. We complete each other. But we never should forget about the rules of ordinary people inside Iran. We never should forget about those ordinary people, ordinary women like me. Because I grew up in a small village. And as I said, my family, they had fear about feminists. But I learned from women rights activists inside Iran that I have to go in politics, but push for ordinary women. So I'm kind of, I can call myself here in a, actually spy. Because I wanted to make a link between ordinary, the society, and the politicians, which I was not successful when I was in Iran. That I learned from social media. And I found a way that the only way we can actually, you know, make those women in politics responsible about women's rights issue is just to empower ordinary people and give them a platform. Those women who were silent in you know, society and marginalized within the society, and through cyberspace, we can give them a voice. We can make awareness. And if I have the time that now I can give you some examples about how we made those female politicians in public responsible about some issue which they never thought this is important, which is about women body, women identity, and women existence in society. Do I have time?
Yeah, have you had such experience?
Yes. So through Iranian media, so I'm a journalist. That's why I'm going to focus on women's status in media organizations, because before, you know, social media, women were not part of, you know, making content for media. Women were victimized, not only in Iranian media, through Western media as well. I mean, I myself, when I was invited to go to media to give, you know, interview, I was witnessing that in the background, women were just, you know, the victims of acid attack, or those women were suffering from, you know, violence with kabudi, chimisha?
Darkness.
Bruise?
Darkness.
Oh, darkness on their eyes, a bruise. So women were victimized through media. So in that time, I thought that through cyberspace, we can show the other face of women, even in the West. Then we can ask more, you know, we can bring the issue on the agenda and talk about these women are not victims, they are fighters, they have demand, and you have to care about it. So through my selfie freedom, because this is my experience, so I'm going to tell you what happened. From the beginning, female politicians, definitely they were ignored us and make fun of us. Men make fun of us. They never took us serious because they think this is a small issue. And I always used to tell them this is about our identity. We don't care about a piece of cloth. It's about the way that we present ourselves in society. Within the society, we are someone else. We are not our true self. Within the media, you never see your true self. You see someone else which is not, you know, representing your true self in your own country. And from the age of 7, you have to be someone else with a fake identity in society. So when I created my selfie freedom, I always said that this is from those women rights activists inside Iran, empowering women, giving them agency, and letting them to be their own voices, to be their own storytellers. And after a while, I just realized, from the beginning, yes, the government of Iran attacked us a lot. The Friday prayers, political figures, the clerics,
But after that, we keep hearing the word compulsory hijab, rather than saying that this is an order from God, especially in Iranian state TV and some events in Iranian university talking about compulsory hijab. Why? This is women, ordinary women's power, which make a huge conversation, not even in Iran, in the world, and in the political atmosphere as well. First MP, Parvaneh Salahshur, the moderate one, she mentioned that I am against compulsory hijab, even I'm wearing hijab, but I hate compulsory hijab and I'm supporting freedom of choice. So that made those ordinary women's message sent, and that made them empowered. But after a while, yes, she said that she made an apology by expressing herself about freedom of choice. But the thing is, this is the victory of ordinary women inside Iran. And through social media and cyberspace, I have to say that feminist is not something has a leader on the top or organizational chart. Every individual person through social media can be leader. That's my point.
Thank you. But for those who may not have a clear vision about what is going on in the women situation in Iran, maybe it is better to mention that how is it now? Don't you think that there is no tendency in state to provide more opportunities for women taking more power in the politics, in the economical levels? Who do you think has more influence in women empowerment inside and outside Iran, Saga? Who has more influence on influence in women empowerment inside or outside? Do you think those activists inside Iran has more influence, or maybe a person like Masih outside Iran, or you, or Mansoura? Do you feel that you have influence?
Okay. Definitely, I have. But to be honest, I think everyone who's doing the good job inside or outside have a good influence. It doesn't matter. I mean, to be inside, it does matter in some extent, but it's not all about that. It's not about just being in Iran or just the number of years living in Iran. Because as I said at my introduction, that I never been involved in women's movement in Iran, because I've been working in a factory. I was a warehouse manager, working most of the days from morning until 11 or 12 p.m. because I didn't want to be failure. Because if I was failure, Sagar wasn't failure. A woman was a failure. This is a difference between a man and a woman who's working in a very male-dominated, especially the factory. For example, in the last factory that I was working, there were 800 laborers and just 30 women. So it is really difficult to fulfill your responsibility. You have to work five times more than men to be good for them. They said, and then they would praise you. You are like a man. You are working like a man. Then it seems that you never are good enough as a woman. And about the influence that... Okay, if it's about the age or if it's about the living in Iran, so Ayatollah Jannati would be best expert and more influential person because his age and the level of the engagement in politics and everywhere. So I would say because inside we don't have much freedom of speech, so we should know that, because we always know about the women doing the grassroots activism inside Iran. We always appreciate that. But the problem is, when it comes to, because there have been lots of talk around that and discussion, they don't really sometimes appreciate the women's activism outside Iran. And they're always saying that, just recently somebody made a comment for me that if you were a good women's rights activist, you were in Iran and you were in prison. So it seems that whatever government limitation or whatever government like suppress your personal and your civil rights, it's that it's a kind of a gauge that how good you are. And I see that even the many women's rights activists who are free from prison and they start some activism outside, like a person like Nasrin Sotoudeh, that he been doing activism in front of, what was the name of the building that he was doing activism? Bar Association in Tehran, because he wanted to get back her license. And then some people started to ridicule her because he wasn't inside. So inside is really important.
Yeah, but Mansour, I would like to ask you, how do you see this, the real situation? You know, for me, activism for women's rights in Iran, it has been like something impossible, because I'm observing, for example, that recently, I mean at least one year ago and more, that women try to make a campaign for named changing the men-dominated face of parliament. I think you were connected, or you have more information about this campaign inside Iran. But they have been suppressed. We have Homa Hutfar. She was in prison. You know her story. She was doing academic job or something not that much dangerous, but she was sentenced, just condemned because she was feminist, and they just mentioned in her in their condemnation that's why we are targeting her. How do you describe the situation inside Iran for activists, women activists inside Iran?
Okay. I prefer to talk about some general issue, not by case, because everybody knows about the case. But actually, if we look at women's empowerment or women's activities have a free atmosphere to do our activities, it's not a gift. It's not a state gift. Neither it's not a dedicated crown on the head to be an activist, and nobody bother us, nobody pressure us. No, we are discussing about the social movement context, and in social movement context, the empowerment and the freedom is a result of gradual procedure. Yes, it would be a gift if we are reached by our effort, by our effective effort. For example, struggling, I have already several times talked about moving geography or non-geography of women movement in Iran. Several times I have written about it. A struggle by Iranian women inside should be supported by Iranian women outside of Iran, by international women's rights network, as well as Iranian women in diaspora, as well as we are here. We should go forward and advocate the mainstream discourse from inside by connecting with international women networking, by relating independent organization, while we are also following the mainstream discourse of feminism, international, global feminism outside of Iran. Actually, all of us in Iran and in diaspora, we are fighting for international human rights standard. We from outside of Iran shouldn't be ignored by some argument, either on basis of cultural relativism or cross-cultural, something like that, cross-cultural argument. Our right should not be sacrificed for diplomatic strategy and economic reason, I would like to look myself, to look at myself as a diaspora Iranian feminist whose duty is to encourage international human rights defenders such as European civil society, European intellectual, writer, journalist, artist, activist, to support Iranian women movement toward a positive, civil, gradual, and permanent changes. This is our task as Iranian activists who are living in diaspora.
Thank you. Masitan,
you
have been...
I want to add something because it's a fantastic argument. And I myself have a lot of struggle to make this clear for international community. And I want to use the opportunity.
Yeah,
if
but
you don't have any questions.
Yeah, I think I would ask the same question because I think you and some other activists like you has been... has been labeled as outsiders, but you always argue that your campaign or your activities is based inside Iran, not outside, and you are not an outsider, or those who are active. Yes,
I really enjoyed the argument, which we have been ignored by some international communities, by cultural, you know. Let me give you an example, recent example, about a US female chess champion. She said that she's not going to participate in a tournament which is going to be in Iran. Why? Because she does not want to wear compulsory hijab. Mm-hmm. This is her basic right. It's clear that she has the right to say, I don't want to wear compulsory hijab. When, just imagine, when she was invited, she was a Muslim chess champion, invited to go to France, and the condition was that, take off your hijab, then participate in the tournament. That, she would have done the same, saying that, I want to choose what I want to wear. But now we have been criticized by Western medias and some lefties activists saying that caused white savior complex. I do not understand that. Imagine if she was black. They would have called it black savior complex. She is a woman. When we talk about women's right, we talk about sisterhood. We talk about our own right. We don't talk about colors. We don't talk about, you know, what surprised me, that she was even from the minority Russian. She was not even Western woman. And she talked about her own right. But I want to add something here, that when we talk about women's rights, we talk about human rights. When we talk about freedom of choice, it doesn't matter. It happens in France. We were loudly and proudly condemned burkini ban. And you never heard that some people saying that it's an internal matter. Let's not talk about it. It's a law. Let's not break the law. Let's respect the law. And we never heard that some people, you know, try to keep them silent. But we, all of us, a lot, not just from our government, from Western media, keep hearing silent. This is an internal matter. This is a cultural issue. It should be solved within the society. How? Narges Mohammadi, she has been sentenced to be in prison for 16 years. What she has been doing, condemning compulsory hijab on her hand, and she was an anti-death penalty activist. So what is the result now? She is in prison. And when she was there, before going to prison, and I've done an interview with her. So she never said that you're an outsider, and I'm not going to talk to you. But New York Times, Guardian, they are saying that. Outsider, keep silent. And when they call it white savior complex, then how they ask the chess champion to go Iran in order to empower our athletes, in order to empower our chess player inside Iran. Doesn't it call white savior? Here, no. So for me, I have been labeled a lot that I'm, you know, supported by Israel, America, intelligence service, but I always, I am loud, as all my fellow colleagues, human rights activists, journalists, that we condemn human rights abuse, whether it happens in America, in Israel, in the West, or in Iran, as we were loud enough to condemn Burkini ban. But we are not successful to invite female politicians who go inside Iran to talk about women's rights. Why? Because they care about bigger problems, so-called bigger problems. And they never want money, actually. And they never want to talk about human rights issue. And they always justifying their silence with this. We want to, empower Iranian women in other way, and we keep silent. But where is the result? Nasrin Sotoudeh, Narges Mohammadi was the one that she put her in danger to meet with Catherine Ashton, the high representative of the EU. But now, can you hear anything from European Parliament?
No.
Catherine Ashton, I mean, directly I'm talking about Catherine Ashton because she was attacked by Iranian government. So we don't hear anything from female politicians about Narges Mohammadi. She's the one, she's a true fighter inside Iran, never, make a fake barriers between outsider and insider. So to make it short, we complete each other. I'm a human being. I'm not like a Bad Badak. How can I say Bad Badak now?
Balloon.
Now I'm free, and someone said that now you're free and go. No, I'm a woman from Middle East. I carry the scars of war, the scars of sanction, the scars of humiliation, the scars of discrimination. I carry the scars of being an exile. I'm a human being. I want to talk about my right. Doesn't matter where I'm in Iran or out of Iran. But basically, I am in Iran. Here, I'm like a tourist because every day we all wake up with the news of Iran. We go to bed with the news of Iran. So no one can make a, just artificial barrier to keep us silent.
Wrap up the discussion, which was very interesting. I wish we had more time to talk more. I would like to ask you about the role of internet and cyber activism, cyber feminism in the context of Iran, because nowadays we see that women are more and more in internet and use the internet as a tool to demand their rights. For example, in your campaign or in different ways of being loud, being heard, they are trying to use the internet. Do you think women activism in Iran would continue its struggle through internet, and how successful it is? I would leave it for each one you like to answer this question.
Okay.
Merci.
You would like. Okay.
I make it a very short comment and I pass it to Merci. First of all, we should know that in Iran that we don't have free access to public spaces like the way people enjoy in West or many other countries, that they deny or street buildings and all kind of spaces to activists, and including women's rights activists. I remember that any time that women's rights activists want to have a kind of gathering and they kind of renting or hiring a place to have their own gathering, always they stop and they couldn't. Even 1 million signature campaign couldn't launch their campaign in the first day because they didn't let them to do that. They said they got the permission for that, but they deny, and then they had started the campaign on the street, which is symbolically it's very interesting. And the other things we should remind ourselves that more than half of Iranian population is under 35 years old, so we have a very young population. And the other things is Iran has 46 million internet users, so people have access to internet, and the cyberspace make us kind of spaces that we can all negotiate, fight and talk and all kind of changing ideas, which it was denied in Iran for decades, and especially because of the censorship, heavy censorship in Iran, we didn't really had enough time and space for talking. And this kind of social networks and stuff, it made opportunity for us to engage with the different ideas and just challenging each other, questioning each other, mobilizing the things that, and when the Iran have a heavy hands on the cyberspace, that you see that we did a good job, because they use it themselves, although they filter most of high-profile website around the world, like a Twitter, Facebook, but Ayatollah Khamenei himself has like five, do you call it account in Twitter? Yeah, he has five accounts in Twitter. He doesn't follow anyone, just follow himself. And one is account from Khomeini's, on the name of Khomeini's made the account. So it seems they want even themselves use it for their own will. But so this is the way that many times as Ayatollah Khomeini's speeches, you see that he's so worried about cyberspace. And from the reaction, you can understand that they hire many people to just, you know, to disable our activism in cyberspace. Even happened in the Massey's page. For sometimes, they pay a website and they come up, 100 people would come up with nonsense comment, and you see that the profile are not Iranian. They are all around the world. They paid, you know, to some people to come and disable this page. So it seems that this page did a good job, otherwise they wouldn't bother.
Excuse me? I prefer to message.
Sure. No, because we are, you, my mother's too.
It's small too. Uh-huh. It's small, ma. No. Okay. I think about when we want to talk about the impact of cyber area and internet networking, we must remind the Arab Spring in 2011, which alerted the effective and the importance of internet technology and the network, internet cyber network. But cyber and internet network was not able to do effective mobilizing tools in the Arab Spring, but did not on their own procedure the social uprising. They were not successful to make social uprising, but for mobilizing, yes, they do. In Iranian case, in the case of Iran, the use of cyberspace, it was a defensive tactic, particularly for Iranian women's movement. And later on, it was the opportunity because of the meaning, you know, the meaning of women movement for us, it means a movement without head. And this meaning, realizing by internet area, but cyber area with us, for us. So the opportunity of this kind of atmosphere created an important theory of self-reliant cell from feminist school group. By this theory, the women movements started to create several pluralism group to internet area, to cyber area, to publish, to make opportunity to publish their idea. Those, for example, don't have never ever the opportunity to publish their idea, particularly about feminism, because in the time of Ahmadinejad, only the word of feminism was a crime. Only the word, one word about feminism, and especially feminism meaning, feminism term, could be able to delete, to censor a huge book about, for example, feminism, literary, criticized, or everything. That's why this area make us opportunity to publish our idea freely. And for example, being without a head, it was the same approach in women movement. However, access to internet by women make a lot of freedom, but in the other hand, cyber activities could be also decrease political action, as people, for example, can feel that just signing a petition on the internet or liking a breaking news or a report or a post, and you know, itself is not a political act, but such activity may go no further more, but the people forget their responsibility, their political and social responsibility and in the civil field. This phenomenon has been recognized as collectivism, something against opposite of cyber activism. For example, people simply click or like or sign online petition, something, some comment or some sticker at the moment, and nothing more. Asif Bayat, Iranian sociologist, called this kind of action non-movement. We can say it could be either in cyber area or real area. Both is non-movement, but I suppose that if these non-movement gather enough support, can mobilize a lot of independent medias and the support of the women's movement, then they have the opportunity to become an effective cyber social movement. I think the reality of this area is that the women's movement cannot be limited to either cyberspace or real space. Both spaces are needed. The Iranian women's movement is now trying to understand how to be active in both eras. The important effect of using this area, the latest result was the campaign you have already mentioned about it. This campaign and the change mail, the what was the name? Especially change of male dominated parliamentary.
The face of.
And actually, this importance effect of social network and cyber feminists does not just melt away into collectivism. It is remaining. It could be a cyber social cyber social movement, cyber social movement. Sorry.
Yeah, thank you, Mansoor Can. I think it's a vast subject.
Yes.
We should talk about it more and more, but unfortunately we don't have time. I don't know if we can get some question from the public, or we are already done.
Sorry, I just want to ask you, why do you think what happened, for example, a few weeks ago in Poland, why don't we get such protests in Iran for hijab?
You want me to call for protests today from here? That's a good question, because I often get this question, that when there are a huge number of women are not happy about compulsory hijab, why they don't, you know, come to the street and take the street to protest against it. But the thing is, the level of oppression is really high in Iran. And those people who were involved in the green movement, you know what happened to them. More than 100 people got killed in the street of Tehran and other cities. And we had Kahrizak detention, the notorious detention which caused the 9 people got killed. I'm not the right person to criticize the people inside Iran that why don't you get, you know, the street and take the street to protest against compulsory hijab. But what I'm criticizing is all the female politicians, international female politicians. Why? Because this is they're responsible to protest against compulsory hijab as well. I'm not asking them to save Iranian women, but it's about them as well. But if I ask Iranian women to come to the street, I feel guilty. I know that they have done their best. The world heard their voices. And to me, change not come through the policymakers or the politicians. Change come through Iranian women. And the government cannot control them. As you see when the Supreme Leader of Iran said that biking is haram for women. Women are forbidden to ride bicycle in Iran according to our Supreme Leader. Why? Because you can excite men. Men cannot get, you know, men cannot control themselves while seeing you riding a bicycle. So what was the reaction? What was the reaction? Women took the social media, but it was not just the social media. You heard their voices through social media, but the main action happened in the street of Iran. Women were biking in public on their bicycle and talking directly to the Supreme Leader of Iran. I call this an individual and one-person demonstrations. Yes, freedom is not free. You have to pay for it. But I think women, ordinary women themselves, they're paying for it. And to me, there is a daily war in Iran. Daily war for women. I can call women soldiers in Iran every day, which I called it cultural war, lifestyle war. The war between, you know, the government want to force women to follow their lifestyles, but these women every day fighting, and they have their own lifestyles. Through social media, you heard the true voice of Iranian women saying that, we don't care what you're saying. We're biking. We keep biking. And I think they got the street of Tehran. Through my Selfie Freedom as well. They got the street of Tehran. And who are failed? The politicians, celebrities, those women who are in power. But ordinary women, if you go to Iran, you never see those women always you see through Iranian state TV. You will see the different face of Iran. And I think they won.
Thank you very much. Yeah, Mansoor-jan, please. But there is no question.
I'm terribly sorry. Thank you. I'm sorry.